laboratory. I've had the the privilege of knowing Dr. Pindak going back close to 20 years to an experiment at Brookhaven National Laboratory at the National Synchrotron Light Source on the beamline that I was operating there when he approached from Bell Laboratories with the a very fascinating idea for an experiment and that it led to many, many interesting interactions. Dr. Pindak got his PhD in physics from the University of Pennsylvania after receiving a bachelor's from Boston College. He did a postdoc at Harvard University and then was a member of and a leader of the technical staff at Bell Laboratories for 24 years, as far as I can tell. And then joined the National Synchrotron Light Source at Brookhaven National Laboratory as a staff scientist and has been there since, rising in responsibilities until he's now the manager of the complex scattering program of the photon division of the follow-on instrument, the National Synchrotron Light Source 2 at Brookhaven, and he's here to tell us about very interesting structural studies. That, Dr. Pindak.
Okay, first of all, I'd like to thank Lars and Michael Hart for the kind invitation to come and address this audience. I'd also like to thank the faculty who took time from their busy schedules to tell me about their work, a lot of which I think is fascinating, and I hope there are some ways we might find to work together. If nothing else, I would like to convince you today that optical and synchrotron X-ray measurements are really complementary techniques, especially when you're trying to understand the complex structures that occur in soft materials, soft liquid crystalline materials that order over a wide range of different length scales. The work that I'm talking about today was largely done in this facility, which is our old synchrotron. It ceased operations about 2 years ago. It's now completely empty, might become a new computer center. But it's been replaced by this new synchrotron facility, which is about four times the size, four times the complexity to operate. But the advantage is it has 10,000 times a brighter source. So it just completed the first set of 10 beam lines that are now operational. Next year we'll add another 8, and the year after that it'll get up to about 28 operating beam lines. The nice thing about a synchrotron is it's an electron storage ring, so the electrons are circulating around the ring at the speed of light and giving off synchrotron radiation, which is white radiation, and by building beam lines tangential to the ring, you can take off this radiation and work simultaneously. So we can have 30 different experiments going at the same time, covering a wide range of different science. So it's a fascinating place to be working. Okay, so the system I'm going to be concentrating on today, and I really have to focus on one system because there's a lot to talk about in almost every system that you study. What I'm interested in is these organic molecules that take on a rod shape. Being a rod, especially when the length to diameter ratio gets to be about, there's a magic number of 4.7 that Ansager identified. When the anisotropy gets to be to that extent, molecules start to entropically favor ordering. So from a random orientation in a liquid phase, they begin to order orientationally into what's still a liquid, but aligned molecules. As you go down in temperature, then they might start to develop positional ordering and form lamellar phases. So positionally, they order one-dimensionally. Within each layer, they're fluid. So these are the two kind of phases I'm going to be talking about today and variations on them. So I thought I would, probably most of you are familiar with liquid crystals being used in liquid crystal monitors and displays, but I'd like to tell you from my own background, working for a communications company, I try to use them in a somewhat different way. The problem I was trying to address is this problem of polarization mode dispersion that occurs in the fiber optic network. So if you launch a pulse in a fiber optic, it has a polarization state that can be decomposed into two normal modes that propagate along the fiber. However, fibers are nearly perfect, but just not quite. They have some shape anisotropy, which introduces birefringence into the fiber. They also can have some extrinsic anisotropy due to stress. It might be, acoustic waves from a fiber going under a roadway with trucks running over it. So those tend to be random. And what happens then as a function of time is these two modes propagate down the fiber with different velocities, and then bit train becomes compromised as these pulses start to split apart. So about every 100 kilometers, depending on the quality of the fiber, you need to recondition the fiber. You need to introduce kind of the negative birefringence to pull those pulses back together. And this needs to be done because you're dealing with these acoustic disturbances. It needs to be done quite rapidly at speeds approaching a degree per microsecond. So you typically need a set of three wave plates to do this, quarter, half, quarter, and you need to be able to continuously rotate them at these speeds. So that's the problem that I was trying to address and to see if this could be done with liquid crystals. So I started working with the pneumatic phase, the phase that's liquid with just orientational order. Light polarized parallel and perpendicular to the molecules will propagate with two different speeds that depend on the refractive index difference. So you get a phase difference as you go through a slab of liquid crystal like this that depends on that refractive index difference, depends on the thickness of the slab, and, of course, the wavelength of your light. So you can, by varying the thickness, you can make a quarter wave plate. It takes about 5 microns for the IR frequencies in fiber optics. Or a half wave plate might take a 10 micron size slab. So you can make a wave plate in that way. If you then put a series of electrodes where you can then use combinations of voltages to apply an electric field in any direction, you can then rotate the fast axis of that polarizer continuously to any orientation that you would like. So this is just a schematic of how one might put a device like this together. These are the ferrules that are typically used to couple one fiber to another along the network. So we evaporated these electrodes right on the face of one of the ferrules, introduced a liquid pneumatic liquid crystal in between using glass spacers to produce the right thickness to be a quarter or half wave plate. The device looks something like this. The fiber itself is 125 microns. Most of that is the cladding. The core of the fiber where the light propagates is more like 10 microns. It's that little spot in the center of our fourfold pattern. So something about now speed. Can we hit this speed mark of a degree per microsecond? Well, you can calculate what the response time of the pneumatic liquid crystal should be by looking at the dielectric torque. It's a dielectric effect alignment. It goes like the square of the electric field. You can balance that by the viscous torque that's produced when you try and rotate the molecules. Equating those two, you can get a response time that goes like E squared, and it turns out to be about 3 milliseconds for a 3-volt pulse. And that's really the voltages you would like to work with, but this was the speeds were much too slow. We could, in fact, get it to work at these speeds of a microsecond by degree, but to do that, we had to use 200-volt pulses, and heat raised the temperature. So we could achieve it, but we couldn't make this into a practical device a commercial device because of the high voltages that it did require. But so the pneumatics work fine, but we really need a way of coupling to the liquid crystal molecules with low fields. That's a much faster response. The idea on how to do that is to make use of the smectic C liquid crystal phase. It's like the smectic A, fluid-like layers in one-dimensionally ordered, but in this case, the molecules are tilted with respect to the layer normal. This is a very high symmetry environment. There's a twofold axis. The x-axis is a twofold axis that takes x, y into minus y, z into minus z. There is also a mirror symmetry plane, the y-z plane, and that takes z into minus z. So it's a very high symmetry environment. The molecules have, in that kind of environment, are totally free, even though the molecule itself might have a dipole associated with it. Because of the symmetric environment, those molecules just rotate freely. So Bob Meyer had the idea that why not reduce the symmetry of the environment that the molecules were in? And the idea was to use molecules that were chiral. That is, a molecule that had a group, an atom that had four different bonds to it. So if you try and look at the mirror image of this molecule, it's not the same. It has a handedness to it. If you do that, then the mirror symmetry plane disappears. There's nothing from the point of view of symmetry that disallows a polarization forming along the x-axis that occurs by the molecules having a hindered rotation, and that, in fact, occurs. So you end up now with a spontaneous polarization that you can then couple to with electric fields. The other effect of using a chiral molecule is that you introduce a slow helical rotation. This is on the order of optical to microns in length. So with very small fields, you can unwind this. So it's really a helioelectric phase, if you like, but a very small field will unwind this helix, and you'll end up with it being ferroelectric. If you now look at the switching dynamics, so what you're doing now in this case is you're rotating this tilted molecule in a cone about the surface normal. But now you're coupling to this permanent, this spontaneous polarization. So the coupling is a P dot E term. And if you look, compared to the pneumatic, which at 3 volts switched at 3 milliseconds, putting in typical values here, you end up with a 20 microsecond switching. So it's significantly faster, especially at the low voltages where you would like to work. So I never went back. I left my Bell Labs and didn't try using this in a for a polarization rotator, there are a lot of challenges working with the smectic C layers and not having defects appear, but those have been commercially, those challenges have been commercially overcome. This is an example of a commercial application for this fast switching ferroelectric liquid crystal. It is a sequential digital color device. It's commonly used for head displays and also in projection displays. The idea is, instead of having a separate pixel for every color, red, green, blue, that you turn on and off, this has a single pixel, which is just a switch, on-off ferroelectric switch, and it uses three light sources that are on for one-third of the video frame rate. And during that pulse, you get your color by switching that, opening that liquid crystal shutter, ferroelectric shutter, for different pulse sequences. And you can get down to very rich colors in this display. It can also be manufactured right on a silicon chip, so the transistors to do all the action are behind the display. So now this is I'm going to take just a little sidetrack here. This was somewhat inspired by this year's Nobel Prize, and it involves looking at the mechanisms for the smectic C to A phase transition. Now, in bulk materials, this occurs by the smectic C tilt angle going continuously, this angle theta going continuously to zero. And it's a second or nearly second order phase transition with power law behavior. What Kosterlitz-Thallis, this year's Nobel Prize winner, recognized was when the tilt angle got to be small enough, then the energy that it cost to create an in-plane azimuthal distortion of that tilt angle could spontaneously nucleate pairs of disclinations. So here is a what these arrows represent are the projection of the tilt into the plane of the layers. So this is a positive and negative disclination. If you bring them together, they would annihilate. But if the energy to create this distortion is low enough, in fact, if it approaches thermal energies, then they predict it. You would spontaneously nucleate these defects, and that randomization would effectively turn the smectic C into a uniaxial smectic A. So that would be the mechanism for the phase transition. And this only occurs in two dimensions, because in two dimensions, fluctuations become increasingly more important of the molecules. Also, the elasticity, the elastic energy scales as the thickness. So as it gets thinner, this becomes more likely to occur. So one of the things I wanted to do was to go about and see if I could measure this effect. To do that, we developed this technique of freestanding liquid crystal films. The way that works is you take a little bit of the smectic A liquid crystal, and with a this is a glass cover slip with a rectangular hole in it. You have a little bit of the material at the edge, and with another cover slide, you draw it across that rectangular hole. And this way, you can make films in any thickness from 2, 3, 4 up to thousands of layers thick. You can even make one-layer films, although those tend to be less stable. The two and thicker ones are stable for weeks. You can measure the thickness just by using optical reflectivity. So if we're in the smectic C phase, put electrodes on the side, we can use those electrodes to change the orientation of the smectic C from one side of the cone to the other. What I did was, I won't go through the details because it's a rather standard instrument, was to use a rotating polarizing ellipsometer, sent light through the film at 45 degrees. If you then look down the laser, what's incident is linearly polarized light. As it goes through the film, it gets rotated and elliptically polarized. So these are kind of the two ellipsometric parameters that describe that. So I did this measurement for films 2, 3, 4 discrete, varying their thickness discretely, and by using the known refractive indices and the thickness of the individual layers, I could then fit that data and come up with this curve of. So what I'm plotting here is the average tilt angle. So I'm treating this film as having a single tilted slab. And I'm measuring that effective angle as a function of temperature for different thickness films. The first thing that's evident is when you go down to a two-layer film, your transition temperature, the surface enhances the tendency for the molecules to tilt, so your transition temperature increases by about 30 degrees. And then as you go down in temperature, you start to get back to, and this is what the that tilt angle looks like in a bulk sample. So to understand this data, we developed a model where we had a different tilt at the surface and in the interior of the layers, a different transition temperature for the surface and the bulk, and we could produce these. This kind of theory resulted in these solid curves. They're power law curves. They fit certainly the thinner films very well. They fit the temperatures very, very well. They begin to get a little less good a fit when we get to the intermediate thickness films. But the important thing to notice is that when I blow up this region of the two-layer film, what we saw is that when theta got to this value of about 7 degrees, there suddenly was a precipitous drop. And this, we believe, is consistent with this idea that the sample is going uniaxial by these defects nucleating. We could take this value of theta, estimate the value of the energy, and we were able to show it's about equal to this thermal energy as was predicted. Subsequently, Amador and Pershan did the same kind of analysis, but they focused on just this surface layer, and they showed that, in fact, this surface layer itself was behaving like a two-dimensional sample just riding on this fluid substrate. So I think the takeaway message at this point that I'd like to make is for these tilted smectics, synclinically tilted, all tilted in the same direction, smectic phases, combining optical ellipsometry with the ability to form these smectic layers in discrete steps gives you a lot of information about what's happening structurally. So this, I think, was a very nice success for an optical approach to seeing things that are happening on molecular length scales. However, things started getting more complicated. The synthetic chemist, what they wanted to do was to make molecules more and more polar. So they're introducing these CO groups transverse to the molecule because they want to boost up that polarization, get an even faster response. When they started doing that, suddenly a whole zoology of new phases appeared. Now the question was trying to understand them. The one closest to the crystal actually could be understood with optics. It had, it did not exhibit any response to an applied field, so it had to have an antiferroelectric behavior. And we came up this model. The way you can confirm this is you can make even layer films. The even layer films have no electric response. You make odd layer films, and there the dipoles don't cancel. See, so an odd film then does exhibit a ferroelectric response to a field. So that one you could figure out, but you know there were still all these other intermediate phases, and trying to understand their structure was the next big challenge that I tried to address. Of course, the obvious thing is, you know, you're looking at ordering that's occurring on very short length scales. Why not use X-rays, a probe that has much smaller wavelength? However, if you look at conventional X-ray scattering, whether molecules are tilted synclinically all in one direction or they're tilted in alternating directions, from the point of view of X-rays, this is the same mass density wave. So in both cases, you just see layer peaks at a spacing of 2 pi over the thickness of the layers. So we, with ordinary X-rays, even the short wavelengths doesn't help us distinguish those different cases. However, the nice thing about synchrotron facilities is it's a white source of X-rays. So using crystal optics or gratings when you're dealing with lower energies, you can tune the X-ray energy that you want to any energy that you would like, and you can also continuously scan energy. So the trick that we used was this molecule that we wanted to study had a sulfur atom attached to the rigid core of the molecule. If we tune the X-ray energy just to the point where we're hitting the resonance, electrons get promoted from the core into the bonding orbitals. And this effect is very sensitive to what the polarization of your X-rays are with respect to the chemical bond in your sample. It's very different if it's parallel or perpendicular. So this effect then will be very sensitive to the orientation of the molecules. And when you're sitting on the resonant energy, these two structures will look very different because this one is seeing a very different orientation of the molecules. It's developing now a twofold symmetry. The twofold symmetry means you would get half-order peaks starting to appear in your spectrum. So it would begin to look like that. The other thing that I'll soon show you is that the polarization state of the incoming X-rays also can change on resonance. So the way a synchrotron experiment might go schematically is we have our white radiation coming from the electron storage ring. Using crystals, using Bragg diffraction from a crystal, we select a particular energy depending on this angle. The X-rays are polarized within the plane of the ring, so they come out polarized out of the plane of the board. We then put a powder of the sample that we're interested in the beam. Now, you have to look at the exact sample that you're interested in, because not only does every element absorb X-rays differently, but every element in its different bonding environments will have a slightly different shift. So the absorption spectra, here it's the fluorescence, which is the equivalent of absorption. Every energy spectrum will be different, and it's a nice fingerprint of not only your atom, but its bonding environment. It's very often used if you're trying to do studies of a catalyst, for example, where you're undergoing a change in state. You can monitor those changes of state, chemical state, by looking at this edge. So we select the resonant energy for this sulfur bond, then put our sample in the beam. It only has positional ordering along one direction, so we'll only get scattering when our scattering vector is perpendicular. So that puts us in this reflection geometry, equal in, equal out. Then we analyze. To analyze the polarization state of the X-rays, the trick that we use is to find a crystal that Bragg diffracts at about 45 degrees, or close to that angle. In that case, only the X-rays that are polarized out of the plane of the board will get diffracted. Essentially, for X-rays polarized this way, you're really looking down the dipole radiation pattern, which is zero. So if you want to analyze the polarization state of the scattered X-rays, then you rotate this Bragg crystal detector assembly around the X-ray beam. And that then is allows you to determine the structure. Okay, so this is what the experiment looks like. It was quite a challenge when we went about to do this, because at the time, none of the X-ray scattering beam lines would go down low enough in energy to reach the sulfur edge. Okay, at the sulfur edge, X-rays are absorbed by air, so it's most people like to work in a higher energies where you don't have to work in a controlled environment. So what I needed to do was to find some heroic person who was willing to take their spectroscopy beamline and disassemble it and help us turn it into for a temporary amount of time, turn it into an X-ray scattering facility so we could do these sulfur edge resonant experiments. And there's the hero at the time. I think this is I want to use this kind of as an example of why, you know, it's really not that scary to go to these big national facilities, because at the facilities there are scientists like Lars who are really willing to sit down with you and help you and go out of their way to try and make your crazy ideas, especially if you get their interest, to help you realize those kinds of experiments. And it really begins to look much I mean, this is where all the action takes place. It really looks very much like a lab, you know, something you might set up in your laboratory. So the X-rays are coming in here. We had to use these bellows because the whole flight path has to be in helium, because as I mentioned, air would have absorbed the X-rays. The liquid crystal films were prepared in this two-stage oven. You know, actually, with the tops closed, we set up a microscope external to the oven so we could look in and watch while we were drawing these films. It also, the oven had a rotation stage because for some experiments, it's important to know whether there's azimuthal symmetry. So that was what the experiment itself looked like. This is our first set of measurements. And for us, this was, I think, just remarkable to see, because suddenly you go from just seeing a single peak to a whole set of different peaks appearing on when you're sitting on resonance. This structures with a two-layer periodicity showed half-order peaks. The half-order peaks were actually split. And the reason for the splitting is because, as you remember, the chirality introduces this long pitch helix. And here we're actually that coupling to that helical structure. So we're and the helix is about a half a micron. So we're really seeing ordering from, you know, the micron scale of the helix down to the molecular scale. As some of these intermediate phases we realized had a three-layer periodicity, they gave third-order peaks. Another phase had four-layer periodicity, had quarter-order peaks. And finally, there was another phase that was like the smectic C, except it had a very tight helix. And with temperature, it just varied continuously, so it wasn't coupled to any particular layer number. So this was a wonderful new tool that we continue to improve with time. But we wondered what was the structure of the unit cell. Here I'm presenting what at the time was a common belief. The common belief was that the molecule stayed in the plane and you just got different arrangements, as in this case, two tilted to the right, two tilted to the left. So we wanted to know, was there any validity to that, and could we use X-rays to determine what the structure actually was? This just shows you that how sensitive this is to being right on the resonant energy. Here are those resonant peaks, and as we went tuned our X-ray energy a little bit off resonance, those peaks totally disappeared. So it's very sensitive to being right on the peak. In order to understand what the structure of the unit cell was, we had to start doing some modeling. And here it's important. Usually, when you read X-ray textbooks, you'll see the X-ray structure factor is just a scalar. In actual fact, the X-ray structure factor is a tensor in the same way that the optical susceptibility tensor, optical susceptibility is a tensor quantity. To build up, so we wanted to build up this X-ray tensor. To do that, start off with the molecule itself, which has uniaxial symmetry. To get the right structure factor from a layer, we then hit that with rotation matrices, because the molecule is tilted. And then then we built up the structure factor layer by layer. And so each layer then had this displacement. So we displaced down, that added this phase factor to the structure factor. But then it also had this, could have an in-plane azimuthal angle, and we wanted to allow for that possibility. So we could build up and calculate what the X-ray tensor should look like and then start to predict what structures we might see, what the scattering for those structures would look like. You can also dot the polarization vectors into this. Once you have this tensor, you can also figure out what the polarization should be. So what we discovered was the model that gave us the peak structure that we were seeing was this model where as you went from layer to layer, so the four-fold structure was not planar, but in fact the molecule was rotating by 90 degrees as you went from layer to layer. And of course, we always had to remember that it was 90 degrees plus a little bit from this long pitch helix. So that's what the molecules were doing. And the structure factor then for this arrangement then predicted what scattering we should see. So, and that consisted of layer peaks plus resonant peaks that occurred at 1 over the number of layers in the unit cell. So threefold would be third order peaks. Always, again, this little tweak from the helix. And the prediction was we should get a complete set would involve just first and second order peaks because that tensor could be decomposed into five independent tensors giving these five peaks. In addition to predicting where the peaks were, this also predicted the polarization state. So the plus and minus, the first order satellite said if your incident X-rays were sigma polarized, that first order satellite should be rotated by 90 degrees, and the second order would be back to being sigma. So these are the kinds of things we wanted to check. And this is just showing, let me just do a couple of examples. This was looking at the X-ray scattering from the simple smectic C, just with a simple long pitch helix. So there we just get first and second order satellites, which are due to this helix. And there they are, very close to the main peak from the layer spacing. Here's a case where we had a four-fold unit cell, so quarter-order peaks plus this little epsilon. And here we're seeing the one and three-quarter order peak, the first-order satellite from the 200 layer peak, and this is the half 1.5, which is the half order from that peak, but we're also seeing the half order from the 100 reflection. So we're seeing just the kinds of peak structure one would expect. If we analyze the polarization state, so this is a scan rotating our 45 degree Bragg crystal around the incident X-rays, and you can see we have very good contrast ratio, few parts in 10 to the minus 4, and this is what you would get from the sigma polarized X-rays, which is the incident X-rays. When we went to the quarter order peak, the first order satellite, there the polarization switched to being pi, and we went to the second order peak back to being a half. So that model really predicted both the peak positions and the polarization state. What it missed, and we noticed this when as our instrumentation started getting improving, is that if we did very careful scans through the peaks, we noticed that the intensity of the split peaks was not equal. And this occurred for all of our samples. So we then had to try and see how we could model this kind of asymmetry. What that turned out to be was we needed not a uniform helical rotation, but this distorted helix. So it would jump, instead of 90 degrees, delta degrees, and then 180 minus delta. Delta, 180 minus delta. So this still was our four-fold symmetry, but a different kind of distorted structure. And so these are all very fine details about the scattering, this structure of these molecules that now X-rays are helping us determine. I'll say just a brief word about theory. There have been lots of theories written to try and explain this whole zoology of different phases. Just to give you an idea, if you look at next nearest neighbor interactions and put those in as ferroelectric, then if your nearest neighbor interactions are also ferroelectric, that works fine and you can get this structure. If your nearest neighbor is antiferro, again, you can get the antiferro, simple alternating antiferro structure. But now if your next nearest neighbor interactions, you put antiferro into your model, there's a real frustration. If you just stick to the plane, you can't, this next nearest neighbor doesn't know whether to be ferro or antiferro. So this frustration enters, and a way of resolving it is to go out of the plane. So I think it's that simple thinking that means you can't have, it's very difficult to build a planar model. You really need this freedom of going out of the plane. Now, why this distorted helix? So one suggestion by Hamane and Taylor was that if you look at these smectic liquid crystals are not static. Thermal, like Brownian motion, thermal energy makes the layers ripple, so they're constantly fluctuating. If you have a molecule that's tilted, and it's tilted in the direction of the valleys and peaks of the fluctuations, then there's a very small change in that tilt angle as it fluctuates. However, if the molecule is tilted perpendicular to those valleys and peaks, then fluctuating will change the tilt angle. That costs a lot of energy, so you would like to... So this fluctuations really would like your structure all to be in a single orientation. So they built that into the model to explain this distortion that we see. So that's just some kind of sense of why we believe we're seeing the kinds of structures we're seeing. So we did a lot of work over the years looking at the nature of the different phase transitions between these phases. I'll just mention one that I think is particularly interesting. The smectic C and the smectic C star, those are the two structures. The C just has this long pitch. The C alpha has the very short pitch. So there's no broken symmetry between the two. Those phases essentially have the same symmetry. And if you, by looking at mixtures of similar molecules just with different chain lengths, we were able to map out this phase diagram looking at the pitch as a function of temperature, where we could see that this behavior that's very reminiscent of the gas-liquid transition. It starts out being first order, but then as you tune the concentration, it goes over to a critical point where it switches from being first to a continuous second order. So it's a very nice, I think, analogy with the gas fluid transition. We also started searching for, we saw 3 and 4 periodicities. What about 5, 6, and so forth? So we were able to see clear evidence for a 6-layer periodicity. Again, the scattering could be fit by this distorted 6-fold helix. In between the 6 and the 4, there was this kind of noisy region. We thought that might be a 5-layer periodicity, but we never could. So this blue peak is occurring at 1/6 periodicity. As we cooled down, we never saw a clear lock-in at 5 layers. And there is a group that did electric field induced birefringence measurements where they claim they did see evidence for this. So it may be you just needed this electric field to stabilize it, but we could never confirm that structurally. So this is just a quick summary of the phases that we saw. The 6, 4, 3-fold periodicity. If you look at the spontaneous polarization, the phases with even numbers of periodicities give antiferroelectric phases because their spontaneous layer polarizations cancel, whereas the 3-layer develops a ferrielectric structure. And these are helioelectric, although with a small field, you can unwind the at least the smectic C phase. Now, what was going on in parallel with this X-ray work and was extremely important, as you know, the synchrotron runs, we have 3 cycles per year. We divide the year into these 3 cycles. So you're only going to get maybe a week of beam time every 4 months. Maybe Lars only had the energy, too, to tear his beamline apart with that frequency. So you have a lot of phase space that you're trying to explore, especially when you're looking for new phases. So what helped a lot is in parallel with our X-ray studies, the University of Minnesota group, headed by C.C. Wong, was doing optical ellipsometry measurements. I'm not going to go through the details. It's kind of a standard rotating anode approach. The key here, though, is that there are active optical elements, the rotating analyzers. There were no windows between those elements and the sample. We're dealing with very small effects, especially when we're dealing with films just a couple of molecules thick, so you don't want windows in the way. So this is the kind of results they would see. So just looking at the ellipticity parameter as a function of temperature, as you go through these different phases, you would see clear signatures that there was a phase change. So this was very useful information for us to see where there was possible new phases occurring. And you could tell whether the phase was antiferroelectric because, you know, they're using this technique of switching the field. So if there was no change in the ellipticity parameter, that meant that it was an antiferro phase. So they could give that information. The other cool thing they could do, so with X-ray scattering, we're able to see positional ordering even in films that are 2 layers thick. However, this resonant effect is much weaker. And the resonant effect we could only see in thick films. But with optics, knowing what the phases, identifying the phases in the thick films with the ellipsometer, we could go down to thinner and thinner films, mark these phase boundaries, and see how they evolved with film thickness. So again, there's this really important interplay between optics and X-rays. I think I'll maybe just do one more case. All the work that I've presented so far was done on freestanding films. They're very nice samples to work with because the freestanding films give you almost perfect layer ordering. However, if you were interested in using these exotic new phases and devices, so we would like to see how they would behave in devices. What we needed to do there was find a chemist who was willing to synthesize these molecules with a selenium atom rather than a sulfur. Selenium has its absorption edge at 13.7 keV, considerably higher energy. So those energies can penetrate a device cell, which is typically made up of glass with a rub polymer layer to orient the liquid crystal and transparent electrodes. So that whole device now could be penetrated by these harder X-rays. And we work in this geometry, so we're looking at Qs along the layer normal. Here we could see resonant scattering. And let me just go over one example of what we saw with that. And so this is a case of this, what happened if we were to make a bulk sample of this antiferroelectric four-layer periodicity phase and start increasing the electric field. Well, here you can see that there are a series of steps. There's this one step that saturates, then a very long ramp up evolution, then it locks into its final state. And what we could see with the X-rays is in this state, we got our quarter order peak. As we cranked up the electric field, what happened is it went from a four to a three layer, so an antiferro to a ferri state. And that showed up with this two-thirds order peak. And then as we increased the electric field even further, it jumped to a regular smectic C phase, just with the layer peaks. And then what's happening in this long ramp-up is this helix is gradually unwinding. So we're going from a heli to a ferroelectric state. So I think there's a whole other. I don't have time to go through this, but we did a whole other project where instead of looking at uniaxial symmetric rod-shaped molecules, we started looking at these bent core molecules that now are instead of uniaxial, they're biaxial. And they introduced a whole set of new interesting phases and challenges to try and understand. But I think this is probably a good place to end to give some time for questions. What I hope you take away is that X-ray resonant scattering is an important technique for measuring in complete detail this orientational, nanoscale orientational ordering that occurs in liquid crystals. And I think it can be extended to other molecular systems. And it's also important to look at the polarization when you're trying to decide between different models. And optical ellipsometry measurements combined with this variable thickness smectic films are also very important. I hope I showed you that we have evidence for this Kosser-Lutz-Thallus defect-mediated transition. It helped us identify where the interesting new phases might be, and it extended our resonant scattering measurements to thinner films. Now, the new generation of synchrotrons that we built at our new synchrotron, our scattering beam lines can all cover. We have three beam lines now that can go down to the sulfur and phosphorus edges. We have two soft X-ray beam lines that can do edges of even lighter elements down to carbon, nitrogen. And There are now even area that we have to use, you know, point by point. The new generation of area detectors are also capable of measuring at these low energies. So I'm looking forward to lots of new experiments of this nature and new materials. I hope some of you will find that this might be of interest to understand some of the systems that you're trying to study. And our staff is more than willing to work with you and try and help bring your experiments to the synchrotron. So thank you for your attention.
Questions for Dr. Pindak? Yes.